Good morning, everyone. How are you on this wonderfully sunny summer morning? I'd like to welcome you to worship here at Zion. I know we have a couple of guests that I hope you had a chance to say hi to. Ken and Marlis Thoreau, where are you? Welcome back. Welcome back to your home territory. We love seeing you. If we have any other guests here, I would invite you to sign in on the welcome sheet that you can find at the end of your pew, just so we know that you are here and maybe where you are from, so we know where people are coming when they're here on vacation or visiting family. Where are you from? So you can sign in on that and either give it to an usher on your way out or post it in the offering plate. Today is a very special day for some of our Zion family. Sharon and Larry Strohschein are having their 57th wedding anniversary today. And in honor of that milestone anniversary, they have sponsored our radio broadcast today. So thank you very, very much. This is the last Sunday. If you haven't had a chance to participate in the noisy offering for this month, if you have some change in your pocket you'd like to get rid of, the pail is at the back in the entryway. And this month's noisy offering is going to be shared with our South Dakota Companion Synods in Cameroon and Nicaragua. Middle and high school youth, you will be meeting with Sandra on Wednesday from 2 to 3 p.m. in the fellowship room. So come and join in, have some fun, see what Sandra has planned for you. And then also on Thursday, the Sip with Sandra event is taking place at the Caribou on 6th Avenue, not the one at Kessler's, the one on 6th Avenue. So stop by between 3 and 4. And share some time with your friends and Sandra for some more fun and faith. And this morning we do have another guest with us, Pastor Heidi Youngquist. You can usually find her doing her thing over at Bethlehem on a Sunday morning, but she is generously sharing her time with us this morning to share a message and perform a baptism on Jaden Holler, who, if you could see him, her, him, is totally not excited about this event at all, just sleeping truly like a baby. So we look forward to welcoming him into our family of faith. So are there any announcements from the congregation? The rest of the announcements are in your announcement sheet, which I invite you to take home and look to see which ones are pertinent to you for committee meetings, etc., throughout the next couple of weeks. So why don't we begin our worship service with our gathering song, Come. Now is the time to worship.
Thank you.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures now and forever. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves. Amen. Amen. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you and also with you. Let's continue with our song of praise. Lord, keep us steadfast in your word. This one's in the hymnal, number 517. It's also up on the monitor.
I call on the children to come forward for the good news time. Come on up. I do have treats if you come. Okay. I have three things here. Can you help me tell everybody what they are? What's this one?
Book.
It's a book, and it is a special book. It is the Bible. And then what about this? What is this?
An apple.
And then what is this?
Skittles.
Skittles. Okay. Can anybody tell me what these three things have in common? The Bible, an apple, and Skittles. Any ideas? Well... Well, maybe, yeah. So what is an apple? It is a fruit, right? And Skittles, candy, but they taste like the rainbow, right? But each individual one, there's red ones that taste like cherry, maybe orange ones that taste like yellow that taste like lemon, purple that taste like, so what are those things? Cherry, oranges, lemons, grapes? They're all fruit. Okay, so two things that are fruit. What about the Bible? Is there fruit in the Bible?
No.
No. Actually, today we are going to learn that Paul says the Spirit makes each of us fruit. Yeah, so do you think if I wanted to grow some fruit, I could take these Skittles and put them in the ground? No. Why not? Yeah, they're made in a factory. They're candy. What about this apple? If I wanted to have more apples, would this one apple help? Yes. What would I need to do first, though? There's an apple seed inside, right? So I'd have to cut it open and get the seed, and then if I planted the seed,
and the bird has to poop it out so that.
You know, there's all ways of getting seeds in the ground. Absolutely. So the Bible tells us, though, that there are fruits that you and I can grow inside too. Do you want to know what those fruits are? Can you all help me? The first is love. Can you do that with me? Love.
Love.
Love. The next fruit is joy. Can you do that? Joy. Then peace. Then patience. Then kindness. And then generosity, like money. Then faithfulness. And then gentleness. And self-control. All of those, Paul tells us, are fruits of the Spirit and things that we can grow in ourselves. They are ways that we can be and live as Christians to spread the love of Jesus to others. Will you please pray with me? Loving God, sometimes we just think that fruit is something that we can pick off a tree. It helps us to taste the rainbow. But today we learn that fruit is a way that we can live in your world, to share your love with others. Help us to cultivate that fruit today. In your name we pray. Amen. So I promised I had prizes. You all can have some Skittles to remind you to bear the fruit. You are welcome, and you can head back to your seats. Thanks for coming up.
Our first reading is from 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 15, 16, and 19 through 21. Then the Lord said to Elijah, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram. Also, you shall anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king of Israel. And also, you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, of Abel-Meholah, as prophet in your place." So he set out from there and found Elisha, son of Shaphat, who was plowing. There were 12 yoke of oxen ahead of him, and he was with the 12th. Elijah passed by him and threw his mantle over him. He left the oxen and ran after Elijah and said, "Let me kiss my father and mother, and then I will follow you." Then Elijah said to him, "Go back again, for what have I done to you?" He returned from following him, took the yoke of oxen, and slaughtered them. Using the equipment from the oxen, he boiled their flesh and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he set out and followed Elijah and became his servant. Word of God, word of life. Our psalm is Psalm 16. Please read responsibly. Protect me, O God, for in you I take refuge.
I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good
As for the holy ones in the land, they are noble, in whom is all my delight. My chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me. Therefore my heart is glad. My soul rejoices, my body also rests secure.
For you do not give me up to shame, but I let the faithful ones see the pit.
You show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Our second reading is from Galatians chapter 5, verse 1 and 13 through 25. For freedom in Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become slaves to one another. For the law is summed up in a single commandment: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another. Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. For those are opposed to each other to prevent you from doing what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Now the works of the flesh are obvious: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmities, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, faction, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. I am warning you as I warned you before. Those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with his passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. Word of God, word of life.
Praise be to God.
Please stand for the Alleluia.
Gospel according to Luke, the 9th chapter. When the days drew near for Jesus to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem, and he sent messengers ahead of him. On their way, they entered a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him, but they did not receive him, because his face was set toward Jerusalem. When the disciples, James and John, saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" But he turned and rebuked them. Then they went on to another village. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." To another he said, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." But Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home." Jesus said to him, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." The gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Grace and peace to you, dear siblings in Christ. And may the Spirit of God enfold you this day. For freedom, Christ has set us free. I have to admit that this week I've been wrestling with these opening words of Paul's letter to the Galatians. I don't know about you, but freedom is one of those words that sets off alarm bells whenever I hear it these days. Unfortunately, in this political climate, freedom has become a sensitive topic and carries the potential to set off an embattled debate about what freedom is and what it is not, and what rights and choices our freedom entails. Next week, we will be celebrating our nation's independence and the freedom that is the bedrock of our national identity. In the opening words of the Declaration of Independence, we read these words: "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." Liberty here is another word for freedom. And while we may take great pride in our claim of freedom as an unalienable right that we have in being an American, I wonder if these words from Paul might expand our understanding of Christian freedom and ground us in a deeper experience of what freedom really means. Freedom, according to Paul, is not something that needs to be won or earned or fought for, as Christ has already paid the price for our freedom on the cross. And it is not a prize to be protected, for it is a free gift that we receive because of Christ's death and resurrection. Christ and Christ alone is our source of freedom. Christ and Christ alone has made freedom possible. Because of Christ's crucifixion, his resurrection, we have freedom from sin, death, and the devil. We've been set free from death's captivity. We've been set free from our slavery to sin. We've been set free from the need to earn our salvation and prove ourselves worthy of God's love and forgiveness. This is a freedom that we can stand firm in. Fighting to preserve such freedom merely submits us to the yoke of slavery. For freedom, Christ has already set us free. This freedom is pure grace and pure gift. This freedom ensures that we don't have to worry about being perfect, and we don't have to wonder if we are good enough, and we don't have to climb our way to heaven. Christ is our Redeemer who came to set us free. Christ is our Savior who broke the chains of our bondage to sin, who conquered the power of death, and who rose victoriously so that we might receive the promise of eternal life. Our Christian freedom, therefore, reflects the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. We do not earn it. We are merely the recipients of it. Nor can we lose it. The freedom we have in Christ can never be taken from us. It can never be overruled or overturned. That is one of the greatest promises we are given at our baptism, a promise that we celebrate for Jaden today. In baptism, we are sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. By his death and resurrection, we are given the certainty of God's grace and forgiveness, and we are claimed as children of God, just as we are, regardless of our merit or our imperfections. As a sign and symbol of our Christian freedom, each one of us is marked with the cross of Christ, an indelible mark that reminds us of the love that has been poured out for us and assures us of the promise of eternal life and salvation. Neither the mark nor the promise can ever be taken away. Paul recognized that as humans, we have a tendency to get ourselves in a bit of a mess. Too easily, we can turn our focus inward and forget what true freedom is all about. On the one hand, we cling to our obedience to the law, convincing ourselves that God will be so very pleased with us if we just follow all the rules. And while God's commandments were designed for our goodness and for our life's happiness, using the law as a standard for judgment makes us slaves once again to the law and places us in a position for punishment. For no matter how hard we try or how good we think we are, none of us is capable of flawless adherence. As John the Evangelist reminds us, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. On the other hand, in our freedom from the law, we can run the risk of falling prey to temptation, giving in to the desires of the flesh. As Paul spells out, there is a whole list of actions that pull us deeper and deeper into sin and drive us further and further away from the true call of freedom. When we pursue our selfish desires, our place in the kingdom of God remains out of reach. For in order for God's kingdom to come to us, we must learn to pray in earnest, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done." Returning to Galatians, Paul writes, "The whole law is summed up in a single commandment. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." Our Christian freedom is both intentional and purposeful. This gift of freedom doesn't simply allow us to do whatever we want. It doesn't mean that anything goes when it comes to how we live our lives. Instead, this freedom is meant to shape us and guide us. We are to live our lives with love, not for ourselves, but for the sake of others. As Paul writes, "You were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love, become enslaved to one another." Christian freedom is not just a perk of our membership in the body of Christ, a special status that we can claim in order to set ourselves apart, or an advantage for us to use for our own personal gain. Instead, our freedom orients us to the needs of others. As Ronald Reagan once said, "With freedom comes responsibility." I think Paul would agree. As Paul reminds us, we are to use our freedom in love and service to one another. Freedom is not a relief from obligation. Rather, it provides us with the opportunity to live and be led by the Holy Spirit. We are called to walk in the Spirit, to walk in the way of Jesus. In the early days of the Christian church, Christianity was first called the Way, as early believers were taught to live in a certain way, the way of Jesus. As Christians, they understood themselves to be followers of Jesus, and as a result, they sought to live according to the example Jesus provided. As Jesus' disciples, as his followers, they understood that their lives were to be shaped by the unconditional love they saw in Jesus. While they were free from the demands of the law, they were not free from the obligation to love. And so it is with us. You and I have been set free with a purpose, to offer the same gift of freedom to others, a gift that is expressed not in judgment, backbiting, or hate, but in love. In our freedom, we are called to love, not to make demands, not to promote fear. We are simply called to love. But as you and I both know, love, while it sounds warm and fuzzy, can be a mighty tall order. There isn't much that is simple when it comes to love, for true love requires that we put the needs of others above our own. True love requires that we side not only with the winners, but the losers as well. True love requires that we do the hard work of not only protecting our own interests, but in securing the safety and well-being of the lost, the lonely, and the forgotten. True love knows no boundaries, no limitations, and must include every neighbor in need. This is what Christian freedom entails. No dividing lines, no conditions, no qualifications. Thankfully, just as our freedom does not depend on us, we are promised that when we live into the freedom Christ has already won for us, we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And when we live in the Spirit, when our lives are guided and shaped by the Spirit, our lives will bear the fruit of love. Not just love, but joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. When we live into the freedom Christ offers, the Spirit in turn makes us fruitful, enabling us to bear fruit that grounds us in our freedom and orients us to our neighbors. Guided by the Spirit, we are able to love unconditionally. We are free to experience joy for all that Christ has done for us, for the love Christ has given to us, for Christ's eternal presence with us. When we walk in the way of Jesus, the Spirit brings us peace. Peace in knowing that we have been set free from worry, free from judgment, free from having to prove our merit or worthiness. And peace, knowing that we've been given the promise of eternal life. With the Spirit as our guide, we bear the fruit of patience, more than just the ability to wait or to manage uncertainty. This patience reflects the power of hope as we place our trust in God's steadfast love and faithfulness. When we live by the Spirit, we live with kindness, not only seeing the needs of others, but setting our own selfish desires aside in order to focus on the well-being of others. Motivated by the Spirit's goodness, our lives are shaped by generosity. More than what we do with our money, this generosity impacts our actions and interactions, our words and our thoughts, enabling us to give others the benefit of the doubt. With the Spirit's help, our lives are shaped by faithfulness, not fear. When hard times come, when hope seems to fade, faithfulness allows us to cling to the certainty of God's promises and reminds us of God's goodness, God's graciousness, and God's steadfast love. By the Spirit's power, we are able to boldly and bravely exhibit the fruit of gentleness. Rather than crush others with our power and might, rather than seek to put others in their place, the fruit of gentleness grounds us with humility and grace and enables us to bear with one another, to offer them care and compassion, and to seek unity for the common good. Finally, and perhaps most importantly, when we walk in step with the Holy Spirit, the freedom we experience is maintained by the spirit of self-control. No longer clamoring to protect our personal agenda or fighting to assert our power and privilege, when we are aligned with the Holy Spirit, we are able to maintain control of our tempers, our desires, and our choices. Brothers and sisters, we have been called to freedom. For freedom, Christ has set us free. This freedom, however, is not merely a right to be protected. It is not a status that sets us apart or provides us with privilege. Our Christian freedom is a reflection of the love and grace of God revealed to us in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. In being called to freedom, we are called to live in the Spirit of God, to share the gift of freedom with others, and to bear the fruit of freedom we have found in and through God's Spirit. And as I said at the beginning, may the Spirit of God enfold you all, that you may know the true gift of freedom and experience the power of the Spirit at work in you. Let us pray. Faithful God, we give you thanks this day that by your Spirit you have set us free. Help us as we live into the freedom you have given us, knowing that we are not freed from the obligation to love. Guide us as we follow you so that we might bear the fruit of your Spirit as we strive to love one another. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
In baptism, our gracious Heavenly Father frees us from sin and death by joining us to the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are born children of a fallen humanity. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are reborn children of God and made members of the church, the body of Christ. Living with Christ and in communion of saints, we grow in faith, love, and obedience to the will of God. Desiree, called by the Holy Spirit and trusting in the grace and love of God, do you desire to have Jaden baptized into Christ? If so, respond, I do. As you bring Jaden to receive the gift of baptism, you are entrusted with responsibilities to live with him among God's faithful people, bringing him to worship in order that he might hear God's claiming, loving, and forgiving word for him. Teach him the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments. Place in his hands the Holy Scriptures, and nurture him in faith and prayer, so that he may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ crucified and risen through word and deed, and care for others and the world God made. Do you promise to help Jaden grow in the Christian faith and life? If so, respond, I do. Sponsors, do you promise to nurture Jaden in the Christian faith as you are empowered by God's Spirit and to help him live in the covenant of baptism and in communion with the church? If so, respond, we do. People of God, do you promise to support Jaden and pray for him in his new life in Christ? If so, respond, we do.
We do.
I invite the congregation to please rise as you are able. With the whole church, let us profess our faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God, the powers of this world that rebel against God, and the ways of sin that draw you from God? Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood, you delivered Noah and his family. And through the sea, you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river, your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you set us free from the power of sin and death and raised us up to live in you. Pour out your Holy Spirit, the power of your living word, that Jaden, who is here washed in the waters of baptism, may be given new life. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. The congregation may be seated. Jaden Elijah, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through the Holy Spirit you give your daughters and sons new birth. Cleanse them from sin and raise them to eternal life. Sustain Jaden with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the reverence for you, the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Jaden, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will have the light of life." Sisters and brothers in Christ, I would like to present to you our newest member in the family of God, Jaden Elijah Holler. As a family of faith, I ask you to join me in welcoming Jaden into the body of Christ as his extended family in this congregation. We welcome you into the body of Christ and into the mission we share. Join us in giving thanks and praise to God, bearing God's creative and redeeming word to all the world. Let us offer Jaden our sign of congratulations.
By the Spirit, we pray for the church, the creation, and all in need. God of faithfulness, set the faith of your church firmly on you, rooted in your self-giving love. May the church find freedom in loving our neighbors. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of gentleness, strengthen the earth's ability to heal. Where there are dangerous storms, bring calm. Where there are destructive fires, bring rain. Protect homes, habitats, and livelihoods threatened by climate disasters. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of peace, guide all those who govern, that they may place the good of their citizens above self-promotion. Anoint leaders of nations with your spirit of neighborly love. Protect refugees and all who live under tyranny or conflict. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of kindness, uphold those who grieve. Support the needs of any who are unemployed, hungry, or have nowhere to lay their heads tonight. Reveal your healing presence to all who are sick or dying, especially Lester, Carson, Deb, Dwayne, Connie, Jerry, Rod, Beth, Harold, Esther, and Don, as well as all of those we now name silently in our hearts. God, have grace. Hear our prayer. God of love, attend those struggling with addiction depression, or uncontrolled anger. Provide support systems and loving companions as they work towards health, that they may rest in hope and know the fullness of joy in your presence. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of every time and place, in Jesus' name and filled with your Holy Spirit, we entrust these spoken prayers and those in our hearts to your holy keeping. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. I invite you to greet each other with a sign of Christ's peace. You may be seated. In the joy and peace we are given through the cross of Jesus Christ, please consider your gifts to Zion that will strengthen our ministry and mission together for the sake of all in need of hearing Christ's love and grace for them. There are several options for giving, one of which is online, another one is in the mail, or you can put your offering in the plate that will be passed shortly. Children are invited to come forward and place their offerings in the For Children Everywhere box, which is right over here. Thank you for your gracious gifts to Zion and for your partnership in the gospel of Christ. While we take the offering, we will sing, Give Thanks. Lord God, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The God of peace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you, comfort you, and show you the path of life this day and always. Amen. Let's end this worship service with number 810, O Jesus, I Have Promised.